Sunday is my favorite day, and I hope it's your favorite day. I was reading in our little devotional book of Our Daily Bread on Friday, and there was a secular survey that said after a study, and they found out that when people meet in large groups, it motivates and encourages them. And this wasn't even anything spiritual. This was just a secular survey. And so it's our privilege today to be motivated together in a bigger group to praise God and to worship and serve Him. So here's our scripture reading before we sing this morning. So listen to this carefully. It says, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth." And so for those of you who can't carry a tune, this still includes you. Make a noise today. Serve the Lord with gladness. I hope you're happy today. I see Riley smiling. Good. We're going to serve the Lord with gladness. We're going to come into His presence with singing. And we know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us. We are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. So come, my friends, now is the time to worship.
Time to give. let's make this next song a prayer over our country, our province, our municipality, and our church family today. Said,
amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning.
As always, it's a pleasure and a privilege to worship God together in this place, and I welcome each and every one of you. If this is your first Sunday with us, a special welcome to you. We hope you feel right at home. A couple of announcements to take care of. First off, immediately after Sunday school today, there will be a, for the youth, by the way, this is for the youth, there will be a going away lunch for Raya and Kaylee at Howie and Pam's place. So please plan on being there. We'd love to see you there for that. Also today at 6:30 p.m. is our outdoor service. That's at the Noctegal's place. Bring lawn chairs, bring a snack to share. Drinks will be provided. If you need directions, talk to Val or Norm. And I'd love to see you there at that as well. And this summer has been a lot of fun, hasn't it? And some of our youth have been out at camp and serving and ministering, and we want to encourage that as a church. So if that describes you, if you are one of our youth that has done any service this summer, we'd love to hear from you. Either contact the office or let Howie know how many weeks that you have served, and we just want to encourage you in that. Coming up on the calendar all too quickly, the month of August is already halfway through. That means September is coming and fall kickoff is coming. And one of the notes that I received regarding fall kickoff, this will be September 10th, but sign-up sheets are at the table beside the mailboxes there. If you have helped out in the past, or you would like to help out this year, maybe you ran the barbecue or brought one, or you were the one that brought the cotton candy machine, or one of the things that that made fall kickoff last year and previous years so special. If you would like to help out again this year, Chelsea would love to hear from you. Leave your name and your email address, and Chelsea will be in contact with you. She's not going to be here for a couple of Sundays, but leave the information so that she can get in touch with you. And we'd love to start the planning process for our fall kickoff on September 10th. Further on in September, our next outdoor service will be at the Schmitz on the 17th. Take note of that. And September 23rd, there's going to be a co-ed clothing swap. So again, if you have some clothes that are either no longer fitting or you just don't like them anymore, bring them to the church and you might find something that you do like and you want to take home, hence the swap. So anyways, that's coming up as well. Anyways, I do want to, at this point, call up our youth who are graduating or graduated and heading out to Bible college. So Ryan, Kaylee, can we call you up to the front, please? And so it's not just me. We want to pray for them. We want to commission them as they go and intentionally spend a time and a season learning about God's word and acts of service. I'm going to put the deacons and the leaders on the spot. If there are any deacons or leaders who want to come and join me, we want to pray over Raya and Kaylee as they start this new adventure. So come on up. We'd love to have you come, and we're going to lay hands on you if that's all right. Actually, I'm going to come between the two of you, and we want to pray for you as you prepare for this adventure. It's going to be a blast. I can't wait to hear what you've learned. So when you come back, be prepared for that, okay? We'll let you off the hook for speeches today, but they're coming, all right? Let's pray for you. Father God, I thank you so much for Raya and for Kaylee, and I thank you for the work that you're doing in their lives, and I thank you for the calling that you've put into their heart to pursue a time in Bible school. And I pray that as they go, Father, that you would send them with your blessings, that you would teach them as much as they can learn, Father, and that you would open their hearts and their minds to the things that you would just have them come to understand. And I pray, Father, that you would continue to refine in them, in their hearts and in their minds, their calling to how they are to serve you and to serve your kingdom and to serve the church. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for their gifts that they've already been using, as we've seen today, and those that know and the various areas that they've served in. Father, what a blessing they have been to the church, and we pray for that example to inspire others, Father, other youth and other adults, that they would see the examples of these fine young ladies and that they would be inspired to live more faithfully as well and be with Raya and Kaylee as they go on this adventure learning more about you. And we just pray this blessing over them, Father. Send them with your Spirit's blessing and continue to use them, Father, for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yep, I'm up next. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Lord, quiet our hearts and minds. Block out all the distractions that we carried with us this morning. Let us focus on you and what you have to teach us today. We thank you and praise you for the promise of eternal life when we put our faith in you. Thank you for this church body and the people gathered here today, and we also pray for those who weren't able to make it here to worship with us in person. We lift up those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. There's, we probably think of a few that have lost. We continue to pray for comfort for them. Those are that are dealing with health issues, and those are that are just hurting. Meet their need. May they feel your nearness and comfort today and in this coming week. We also think about those who are called to be caregivers and have the gift of encouragement. Give them an extra measure of grace as they walk alongside those that are hurting and that are providing a shoulder to lean on. Let our hearts be sensitive to those who are in need. Give us words of encouragement to speak that they may feel your comfort. We want to pray and thank you for Stephen and Margaret Borowski as they are the family of the week. You know their needs. We pray for continued healing and strength. Provide opportunities for them to show love to their neighbors this week. We also bring before you Moosehorn Baptist Church, who is our Northern Plains Regional Ministry of the Week. Pray for guidance and unity for their search committee, their congregation, and the church leadership as they are in the midst of searching for a senior pastor. We pray that during this season of transition, you will continue to bless them as they serve their community. We continue to pray for Bible camps, and as the summer, as the camp season is drawing to an end through this summer, we want to praise you and thank you for these ministries and the opportunities that kids have been given who have never heard about you and that have been introduced to your word possibly for the first time. May the seeds that have been planted this summer by the cabin leaders and the staff grow. We thank you for providing workers for this awesome and vital ministry. We pray for extra measure of strength and energy for the cabin leaders, the support staff, and even for the administration, that they would stay healthy and strong and continue to pour your love into the kids' lives. We know that there are still areas that of need in some of these camps. We pray that you would continue to provide workers to fill these positions. We want to thank you and praise you for the youth, our youth that have served as camp staff this summer. May the friendships and the leadership skills they have been taught continue to develop. We also think about the kids that were campers this year. May they take to heart what they have learned about you, continue to remind them of all the good times they had, and let them also be reminded to continue to pray for those that were in their cabin that may not know you yet. We pray for individuals who have been called to full-time ministry. We thank you for our pastor and his family. We thank you for providing them with a home. We thank you for the leadership that he provides, that Adam provides. May he continue to look to you for direction. We also think of the other missionaries abroad that we directly support. Meet their physical needs today. Encourage those who are feeling discouraged today. Touch their ministry in a special way, that they would continue to know that this is where you have called them to be. Bind the evil one, open the eyes of the lost, and give them a yearning to open up the word and seek you. I want to thank you for the country that we live in. We pray for the leadership, both of the country, the province, the municipality, and even our own leadership here at Oakbank Baptist. Maybe we all be diligent in bringing these leaders before you and pray that they will always be listening. We will be always listening to you and continue to ask for guidance in the decisions that need to be made. We pray for safety for those who will be traveling, and we thank you for the safety for people that have traveled already. And as these summer holidays are and the summer season is coming to an end, we are excited and look forward to our fall season here as we start up the church programs once again. I pray for leaders, that the leaders will be prepared to step forward and that the ministries will continue and grow. And also for the youth who are heading back to school, May we as a congregation surround these students in prayer to protect them from the evils of this world, and let them be a beacon of light. And let us lead by example. Amen.
Last week, we looked at Matthew's account of Jesus' battle with Satan in the wilderness and the temptations. This episode of Jesus' life, along with his baptism, signifies the preparation for the start of his public ministry. Today I want us to look at the very first things that are recorded of what he said once he started to go out and minister. Starting with Mark's gospel, you can open up to Mark chapter 1, and we will be looking at least the other synoptic gospels, Matthew and Luke as well throughout the service, but Mark chapter 1 is where we want to start. And looking at the very first recorded words of Jesus in the Gospel of Mark. This is Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 15. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the Gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the Gospel." Now in terms of a message, this is about as simple as it gets. But that's the beauty of the gospel. It doesn't have to be complicated. It's something anyone and everyone can hear. It's something anyone and everyone can share. It's simple. And we are encouraged and share and commanded to share this very same message with those around us. I think if we were to honestly evaluate things and realize that we have a calling to preach the gospel, what would that look like? What do you envision? Do you envision something like what I'm doing today, where you have to sit down with your Bible and maybe some other resource and reference books and come up with a whole 3 to 20 point sermon? That's not necessarily how the gospel needs to be preached. The gospel needs to be shared in the lives of those who follow in Jesus' footsteps. The gospel message is a simple one. It is simply the good news about the kingdom of God being established. Some of your translations might have what's up on the screen. Repent and believe the good news. Now, good news and gospel are literally the same word in the Greek. Gospel means good news. That phrase, good news, is interchangeable with the gospel. They're one and the same. And I want to look at this small passage of Scripture and the other counterparts in Matthew and Luke's gospel. It's following the victory that Jesus experiences over the devil's kingdom. And that victory is complete. It requires the same response today as it did then. And it is exactly as Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Believe the good news." Mark starts by describing Jesus' teaching ministry in this most simple way possible. Clear, concise words, a simple message, and yet powerful enough to change the eternal destiny of anyone who is brave enough to believe it and to put it into practice. It is directly related to what just happened in the wilderness as Jesus Christ, again, had that showdown with the devil that represented a war between two competing kingdoms. The war of the world, and the devil who holds sway over it, and the war against the kingdom of God that is beginning to be established in the ministry of Jesus Christ. Last week we looked at it and described it as one of the first skirmishes between those competing kingdoms. And again, the competition involves all of us. The battle involves all of us because they are competing for influence over our eternal souls. And Jesus came out the victor, hands down, without having made a single error. Jesus is the victor. And Mark's gospel doesn't describe that battle in the wilderness in detail. If you look just the preceding verses, it says he went to the wilderness and was tempted. That was it. Mark and Luke both go into the details about the three temptations that he was faced, but Mark keeps it simple. Mark gives us some context. He tells us that the public ministry of John the Baptist has come to an abrupt end because he has now been put into prison. But, of course, we know from reading stories about John, and if you read the gospel accounts, that was how it was supposed to go. John was supposed to pave the way for Jesus, and now that Jesus is beginning his ministry, John steps into the background, although from the context, forcibly. He's arrested. He's thrown into prison. But Jesus takes up the baton of preparing, not just preparing the way. John prepared the way. Jesus is now the way. John preached about the coming kingdom of God that would be established through the one coming after him. And now that person is here. He is announcing the arrival of the kingdom of God. And this message is the one that Jesus preaches and teaches the people. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. So what does this message require of us? It's a declaration of the arrival of the kingdom of God demands that we make a choice. Which kingdom do we belong to? Who do we allow to have influence and sway over us? Do we belong to the kingdom of the world that is ruled over by, well, those that are influenced by the devil? Or do we belong to the kingdom of God that has won the victory over the devil and shown us a better way? A simple message with a simple question. Yes or no? Repent and believe the good news. Yes or no? Do we believe in Jesus or do we reject him? With the announcement of the victory of the kingdom of God comes the call to repentance and the call to believe. These are two necessary components for anyone who would seek to join the kingdom of God. Do you want to become a Christian and follow Jesus? This is how you do it. Now, I hope I don't sound too repetitive or too much like a broken record because I keep coming back to certain key verses, but they're so essential and they say it so concisely. Romans 10, 9 through 10, it's a favorite of mine because it's the recipe for salvation. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, you will be saved, for it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Everything that Jesus said when he was starting to preach is right there. You can compare them. If you declare with your mouth, repent. There is a verbal aspect to repentance, isn't there? What is repentance? It is to be sorry. But not just in word, but in deed. There is literally an impression in the word repent in which we have to turn around. It's an about face, 180-degree turn. If you're sorry for what you did, what's going to change? Let's use the example of you stole a cookie from the cookie jar. Nice and simple, but you can substitute whichever sin you'd like for that example. You stole a cookie from the cookie jar and you were caught red-handed. Crumbs on your face, crumbs on your fingers, maybe half the cookie still hanging out of your mouth. What do you do? I'm sorry. Are you? Or are you going back to that cookie jar the next opportunity you get? Because if you go back to the cookie jar, the words are empty. You're not sorry. But if you repent. You change your behavior. You change your attitudes. You're not going to go back to it, are you? And it's the same with sin. If we're truly sorry, if we're truly repentant, we will change our behavior and we begin to work on our character. Repentance is partially verbal, but it requires a follow-through of action. And this is fitting when we talk about declaring Jesus as Lord. The verbal, Jesus, you are right. Jesus, you are in charge. I submit to you. That's what it's saying. We bow to the authority of the one in charge of the kingdom of God. He is the one whose commands we must obey. And it is in Jesus' name that we repent of our sins. And it's in Jesus' name that we're forgiven. And we call him Lord because we want to declare to the world who we follow. But then the second thing in both Romans 10 and in Mark 1, talk about believing, right? It's right there. Believe the good news. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Belief is an important component for salvation. We have to believe. We have to trust. Romans says that we believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead and we are saved. This is the good news of the gospel. Believe the good news, the gospel, about Jesus and what he did on the cross and what he did through his death and his resurrection. He is our Savior and our Lord. The gospel, the good news, believe it. Now let's take a look at what another gospel says. Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 through 17. An account of the same part of Jesus' ministry, although I wonder if it's the same instance. Mark 4, verses 12 through 17, again, immediately following the temptations that we looked at. Now when he had heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum by the sea in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. The land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light, and for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them a light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, the subtle differences between the Gospels are interesting. Now, to be clear, they don't necessarily contradict one another, but rather give us a fuller understanding of what has happened. Different reports of the same event give a clearer picture. Understandably, this time before Jesus started gathering his disciples means he would have had less witnesses to what he said and what he did. But if you look down the page to the next heading, what does he do next? He starts rounding up his disciples. And as the witnesses to Jesus' ministry and his teachings start to build and grow, so too do we get a fuller picture of what is going on. So Matthew's account of what happens after John was put into prison describes a setup for where Jesus would establish his home base. He would primarily live and serve the area surrounding Capernaum rather than Nazareth, where he grew up. Now, a bit of a spoiler alert, when we turn over to Luke's account, we're going to see some of the reason why he set up in Capernaum as opposed to where he grew up, because of the reception he received in these different locations. Also interesting, and another detail that harmonizes with Luke's gospel, is the mention of Isaiah's book in the Old Testament, although both gospels give different passages. Now, you know me by now. You know I'm an advocate for following footnotes. When it quotes scripture, what does it say where it's found from? We're told it's from Isaiah, but it's Isaiah 9 verses 1 and 2 where it declares Jesus' actions with establishing a base of operations and how this is a fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. Now, I might be sounding like a broken record again here, but Matthew's gospel is one of the best ones for pointing out fulfillments of Old Testament prophecy and how Jesus' life and ministry line up with those prophecies about the Messiah. In this passage, Jesus' life is fulfilling a prophecy regarding where Jesus would live, where he would minister, and this message that Jesus begins to preach starts in verse 17, and it is, again, simple, maybe even more simple than the one that Mark recorded. It is clear. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Absent from this account, interestingly enough, is the call to believe that Mark writes about. But Matthew is capturing the essence of what Jesus was teaching from the earliest time, just as Mark did as well. And through reading both of them, we gain a clearer picture of the message that Jesus would have taught, what he would have spoken, and what would have gotten the people's attention early on. Let's add Luke's gospel to the mix. Turn over to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went out through all the surrounding country, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll, found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Now picture this. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." We could continue to read for a bit, and there's ongoing discussion, and again, it fleshes out that reason why Jesus doesn't establish his base of operations in Nazareth, where he grew up. But I think we've read enough to realize that there's just a different reception for him here. So what happens here that is different from the other Gospels? Well, Luke describes that Jesus' ministry had already begun. It doesn't give us his first ministry words, but rather he gives us his custom. He would go to the Sabbath or to the synagogues on Sabbath days, and he would go from place to place, and here he returns to his hometown of Nazareth, and on the Sabbath he goes to the synagogue, and people had already started hearing about this itinerant rabbi from the wilderness kind of making his rounds, and people were starting to look forward to hearing what he had to say. We don't even have reports of miracles yet, although the scripture that Jesus reads from mentions that he is called to do those things. And of course, Luke's gospel will go on to describe how Jesus does perform the miracles written about in the prophet Isaiah. But like Matthew, Luke describes Isaiah's prophecies playing a part here, although again, a different one, right? So instead of, where was it, 9:1-2? Now Jesus is being handed a scripture. He looks up Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2, and he reads this passage that is about this prophesied Messiah, the suffering servant, the one who would come and do amazing, miraculous things. And then in dramatic fashion, and Luke does a great job of this, he's very obviously a gifted author. He describes that Jesus sits down, everyone's watching him, and he says, "This scripture has been fulfilled in your presence." It is a bold declaration, but it is true. Now, interestingly enough, the simple message that I'd pointed out in Mark's gospel and in Matthew's gospel about repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is at hand, Luke doesn't actually use those words. He doesn't use that phrase. He does not specifically talk about repentance or the kingdom of God as the other Gospels mention, but the prophecy Jesus reads from Isaiah describes the kingdom of God without calling it that, doesn't he? Notice how it talks about how Jesus will proclaim good news to the poor, proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. This passage from Isaiah is a public declaration of the coming Messiah and that he would be someone you would want to talk about. That the things that this prophesied Messiah would do are incredible and impactful for everyone around, and everyone would benefit from the ministry of the Messiah, from the poorest of the poor to the blind and the oppressed. The outliers in society that need it the most, that need the Messiah the most, this Messiah would be good news for everyone. And then Jesus sits down and says, "It's me." These things that were prophesied about 600 or so years ago is fulfilled today in your presence. And you're looking at the one who fulfills them. It's such a dramatic and detailed description of what took place. I can see it fairly clearly in my mind's eye as I read these words. Jesus is the anointed one from Isaiah's prophecy. He is the one who has won the victory over the devil in the wilderness, and he continues to win the victory day after day until his purpose is accomplished. It is incredible to think about and inspiring to say the least, and yet at the heart of it all, the message is clear and the message is simple. And as I bring this message to a close this morning, I want to encourage each and every one of us. We don't have to complicate our faith. It can be so very simple if we would but listen to Jesus. He tells us why he came. He tells us what we are to do about it. Mark said it this way, "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." Matthew said it this way, "Repent, for the kingdom of God," or "the kingdom of heaven has come near." Luke is a little bit wordier, but agrees with the others as he describes Jesus fulfilling prophecy and declaring it to those who would listen. So why did he come? He came because the kingdom has come, and Jesus has a significant role to play in establishing its rule. What are we to do about it? Repent and believe. Turn from our wicked ways and follow Jesus. Why does it matter? Because our eternal souls depend on Jesus Christ and what he has done in order to experience salvation. If we want to belong to the kingdom of heaven rather than to the kingdoms of this earth, we need to turn to Jesus in order to be welcomed in. We need to repent of our sins and our sinful ways, make a 180-degree turn, and start walking towards the kingdom of God. And just as Jesus was raised from the grave, so too do we have the assurance of our own resurrection. It also matters because we need to proclaim the good news as well. And what I hope you get from this message this morning is that the gospel doesn't have to be complicated. Again, you don't need to sit down and write a 3-point sermon on how to experience salvation. You can just tell people in simpleness, repent and believe. It can be boiled down to that one sentence, or it can be boiled down to how you live your lives, because our living examples can speak volumes too, can't it? Some people need to hear the gospel preached. They need to hear that repent and believe message. Others need to see it lived out. To see the life of someone who has repented and believe, and they see the difference in the life. As ambassadors for the kingdom of God, which that is what we are the moment we come to faith, as ambassadors, let's do our best to make sure that we are doing the best that we can to tell people about this kingdom of God, to carry on the message that Jesus preached so long ago, because it's the same message and it's just as relevant today as it was back then. The world is still under the sway of the devil, and we are walking in the kingdom of God, and we have the message of freedom from slavery to sin. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you again for this day and for your goodness and for your love. I thank you for your gospel message and how clear and simple it is. I pray that you would continue to inspire us, Father, to live by it, to embody it, and to proclaim it, to shout the victory that you have won from the rooftops. Father, we give you this day. We glorify your holy name, and help us to live lives in keeping with that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together. Thank you, Pastor Adam, for sharing the gospel with us simply this morning. And we are grateful for him and his family and their first year ministry with us. So tonight we have anniversary cake to celebrate in a small way their first year with us. So as we go to Norman Val's tonight, we're going to do that. But thank you for presenting a clear message of the gospel this morning. Let's sing together and ask the Lord to reign in us.
For joining us for worship this morning. May God bless you as you go, and we'd love to see you in our all-ages Sunday school class right after service if you're able to join us. God bless.